Namaskar to everybody. Certain basic concepts have to be very clear in our minds before we launch upon an activity related to the society today. And what are the problems? What are the solutions? Where do these problems originate? And where do the solutions to the problems of the day also originate? Most of us are not happy with what is going on in this country. We are all aware that something is going terribly wrong somewhere in our public life, in the goings on in the country, cultural, administrative, or whatever. I am not too well today. I hope I will be able to spend some useful moments with you. And at the outset, I am thankful to Manya Sri Sundaram and my friends in the Sanatana Dharma services. Dharma Rakshana Parishat is Sanatana Dharma Parishat. They are not too different. What kind of a dharma are we trying to protect? It is Sanatana Dharma. Suppose we go to a foreign land and somebody asks us, what is Hinduism? What are the basic tenets of Hinduism? Are we prepared to give him a brief answer within a few minutes? To be able to answer this question in a succinct and pithy way, we have to have a wide range of understanding, some depth of understanding, some clarity about it. With lot of understanding only, we will be able to deliver a few sentences relevant to the situation. Like, to teach this at 10th class in a school, one has to be a master of arts. The required knowledge is so much, so that we deliver a part of it relevantly, understandably, with clarity. Many people whom I have met in this country or in Indonesia or Malaysia or other countries like United States, they are listening to many great scholars and spiritual teachers from India. No doubt the speakers are very learned. They are having a deep knowledge about the Indian culture or the Hindu culture in particular. But I found that still the listeners to those speakers are not very clear about what they have heard. They still have the fundamental questions lingering in their minds as before, even after listening to these speeches. Today we are going through a world of intellectualism. The mind is more active than the heart. So we have to meet the questioning mind with an answering mind backed up by a true heart. Our mind should be supported by our heart. So basically the understanding must be deep. Understanding must be felt by ourselves. Then we can deliver a few sentences with some relevance. For example, Some Americans asked me, Swamiji, when do you think the backwardness of India would disappear? I said, India is not backward. Now I cannot quote Upanishads before an American. That is irrelevant to him. He means materialistic welfare. And they would immediately shoot back with the question, how do you say that India is not backward? So at his level, a different kind of answer is required. 10 years ago, in New York, somebody put this question. I said, look, my dear American friend, today there are 49,000 Indian doctors in the universities of America and in the clinics of America treating the Americans. About 250,000 Indian engineers are working in various fields in America. India has not imported a single American, either as a doctor or an engineer. But who is backward? How do you say India is backward? That is quite relevant to the American mind. He is more than satisfied. Talk of spirituality, it is Greek and Latin to him, and he doesn't follow your language at all. Materialistic explanation has to meet the materialistic questioning. But that is not enough for ourselves. We have to have some clarity of understanding of what is India. Way back in 1948-49, some journalists used to funnily refer to India. The constitution says India, that is Bharat. That is where the constitution starts. The journalist used to make fun of it, India, that was Bharat. So, none else than this Babu Rao Patel, who was a journalist of the film field, he used to say, India, that was Bharat. It's quite clear, his understanding of the current India is quite clear. We started with this understanding in the days of independence. We got our independence. Who got this independence? Is it independence of the British subjected India, modern India, old India, medieval India? Which India got its independence is a relevant question. We could successfully drive out the Britishers. In fact, if you go through the history and the many events that preceded the independence, say something like 1944 to 47, you will see a great sense of urgency and anxiety to take over the power. Even without a clear plan of action as to what we would like to do with India of our own. Why do you want independence? What do you like to do with this independent India? What is it that you are not able to do that if the British are present? Well, if the British leave India, what is it that you would like to do? People had funny ideas. The common man was told you can travel free in the railway trains. Common man was gullible enough to believe that. You don't have to pay taxes. Things like that. I would be excused if I say the poor masses were taken for a ride, even by the public speakers at that time. Why? The leaders wanted the mass support to their fight against the British. The mass support is massive without understanding the need for independence. Except some utopian promises and hopes that they were nourished and nurtured in their minds. And what kind of India would we get? It was the departure of the British, and India was divided into Muslim India and Hindu Muslim India. That is the division. Let us clearly understand this. Hindu, Muslim, India already existed. We got the same continuation of the Hindu, Muslim, India minus an exclusive Muslim India. This is what we gained and at what cost. If only you could understand how much of crime, destruction, displacement of millions of people, every family losing at least one or two members, in what? Not in the struggle, but in the process of independence. Struggle was more peaceful than the process of independence. Struggle went on for a long time, but so many people were not killed. But in the partition, I wonder how a country can afford to lose so many people for something which is going to be celebrated by the leaders. Whose celebration is it? Was it the people's celebration? No, it was a political celebration. Those who took over power, into the reins of power into their hands, they celebrated. People were not in a mood to celebrate. Not even a smile could be seen anywhere around Delhi, on any face. People living in the Indian Punjab lost many of their kitchen kin in the Pakistan Punjab. People migrated. People were all living on the streets of Delhi, a beautiful, well-organized British capital of India, became a huge slum. They had nothing to eat, nowhere to sleep, and crying over what they have lost, not only properties but members of their family. Such a tragic situation, I was a witness to it. And then I interacted with many people who narrated their story of suffering, their losses. A young man, aged about 40, whom I met, he said, "Sir, I am the fifth child to my mother. I have two elder brothers. My family, my parents were running away from Lahore. We were to arrive in Delhi, and halfway, even before entering into the Indian territory, our train was stopped, and it was a common sight to see our kith and kin butchered in the trains. My mother had two daughters also, and three sons. Two sons were elder to me. My mother knew very well what would happen to the girls. So she spread her sari. She could hide the two girls under the seat. But she could not hide, and I was also pushed inside, under the seat. And two elder brothers of mine could not be saved. They were standing, aged about 14 and 11. Before my mother's eyes, my two elder brothers were butchered, there beheaded. Is not one family's experience like this enough to wake us up? Should we see millions of people being butchered to wake up to our responsibility? One single story is more than enough to inspire people into patriotism, patriotic reaction. It should be a patriotic reaction leading to a plan of action. That is necessary, and that is one of the many sad stories I have to hear. Several sleepless nights I have to spend after listening to those woeful tales. You all know, 6 or 7 years ago, the Vice President of India, Krishnakant, was a very close friend of mine. His family was very close to Lala Lajpat Rai. His father, Lala Achyut Ram, was a close associate of Lala Lajpat Rai. And they were, if you could have heard to them, you would understand what is patriotism. His mother is still alive, she is 101 years old. He was a vice president of India, promised with the presidential chair, but suddenly given a go-by overnight. Justice was not done to him. You know the reason. He was a thorough, serious patriot. So vice president's chair was all that the country would offer to him. It was the nationalist so-called BJP government at that time. When we asked people like Mr. Vajpayee, no, this Guruji is not a BJP government. It's a BJP-led government. We are helpless. Always there is an explanation. The kind of tales I heard from him, from his mother, from his wife, how they migrated from Lahore. It was a very respectable family in Lahore. They migrated. Now, what is all this about? Why are we suffering today, even 60 years later? Shashyadapurti is celebrated the other day, last August. We are groping in the dark. Now let us think, what is this Sanatana Dharma? What is the basic difference between the Sanatana Dharma of India and the Dharma of other countries? Is it religion? Religion is secondary. Primarily, there is discovery of a secret of human life. There is only one unrivaled, unparalleled discovery in the history of mankind. That is the discovery of the soul in the man. The soul is deathless. It takes a rebirth again and again. What is happening in this chain of births? The soul is evolving. The experience of the soul is evolving, not the soul itself. In Sankhya system, the Atma aparinami, it doesn't evolve, it's not undergoing any change. But it is its experience of the world is changing. So one day it will reach the Creator, the God. In that direction, every soul is traveling, making a long journey through many stations that are called lives, janma, janma parampara. This is the basis of the Aryan understanding. Here it is here that Hinduism is born. Just to tell us what to do, what not to do. What is the real in dictionary meaning of dharma? Dharma is nothing but appropriateness of your action, your thought, your deed, your attitude. Anything should be appropriate to that situation, that day, to that condition. That is dharma. It's the broadest definition. To fight an enemy, mercilessly kill him in a battle is dharma. To save somebody is also a dharma. To kill 100 people to save a noble soul is dharma. Sometimes. To sacrifice one's own life is dharma. To protect oneself is dharma, depending on the situation. Situation could be a battle, could be wedlock, could be love or hatred, facing an enmity, whatever it is. We are passing through different circumstances every day, and these vicissitudes decide the impropriety of your decision, the path, your action, your thought, understanding of it and reaction to it. That is dharma. This complex concept was thoroughly understood by the forefathers, the rishis, the sages, the maharishis. They left nothing unsaid about this. They showed the path, the lifestyle, the style of life, your actions, what you ought to do. Under all circumstances, there is an appropriateness of your action, clearly prescribed in the Dharma Shastras. We say we are a Vedic religion. Yes, Vedas are revelations from the creator Brahma into the minds of rishis who meditated upon the meaning of this creation. What is this creation? Who is responsible for it? Who am I? Where am I? What am I to do? In fact, this kind of a meditation was first started by Brahma himself. Brahmadeva was all alone, sitting at the center of a huge lotus, millions of miles wide, all alone. He was all alone. If you are all alone, what would you do when you have a serious question? You go into silence. You look for an answer from within. That is what Brahma did. He realized who was his creator, the purpose of his own creation, what he has to do with himself first. That is where the knowledge began to evolve. Knowledge was there. It has to reveal itself to us. It has started. This Sanatana Dharma is giver of the path to the human kind. And it started in this Bharat Bhumi. That is the specialty of this country. They call it Doab, between two rivers, Ganga and Jamuna. And the Dharma was finalized and given to us. Right. When this India got its independence, how long was it under subjection? For more than 1,000 years. We had about 6 centuries of the Muslim presence. We had no choice. We were ruled. We were subjected. Our religion itself could not walk around with its holding its head high. It was a condemned religion, a condemned concept of worshipping gods and stones and things like that according to them. And we were called non-believers by the Islam. They called themselves true believers. True believers, believers in truth. Whereas our thoughts were far away removed from the reality, the ultimate truth, and we were in a deluge, we were a blindfolded travel we were making without a direction. So they took that upon themselves to save us from our ignorance. The prescription was, take to Islam, this is the only true path for every human being. Prophet Muhammad has given this. To your benefit, we rule you. And the same slogan was adopted by the British also. Britishers are ruling India, not for the sake, for the benefit of the Britishers, for the benefit of the Indians. With these benefactors, we are the beneficiaries. Whether it is British rule or the Mughal rule. History is known to all of us. And when we got our independence, India was divided. Whatever we have achieved is not called Hindustan. It is India, and it's called Indian Republic. Now there are 3 aspects. The country of India, the nation of India. These 2 are different. And the state of India. There are 3 different things. We are citizens in all these 3. We are citizens of the country of India. We are citizens of the Republic of India. We are citizens under the state of India. This is a very clear, important thing we have to clearly understand. Who got this independence? What happened? It's not the Bharat that was India. It did not get its independence. It continued to be subjected to a new republic. The ancient India was subordinated to a new republic. Let us very clearly understand. It is subordinated by a new republic. What is our philosophy? The new constitution. What does the constitution say? We guarantee equal rights to all citizens. Who are the citizens? The Hindus, the Muslims, the Sikhs, the Christians. All of them are free to propagate their religion, follow their religion. But any reaction to the Christian spread of their message among the Hindu masses, if the reaction from Hindus, it is fundamentalism. Because the guarantee given to the Christian to spread his message or even convert Hindu cannot be challenged. Some experiments have been conducted in the recent decades. Some states tried to ban. It was not a success. Why? The Hindu population did not take to it seriously. It could have been a success. Because we did not support that law or fight its opponents tooth and nail. Republic of India is not Bharat. It's a different thing. It is based on the philosophy called Constitution, the authors of which did not give any importance to the Bharat and its soul and mind. And they had no in their hearts the ancient Bharat Varsha, or the ancient Bharat, the Bharat Bhumi had no place. On the other hand, if some of the Congress leaders try to rebuild a temple, Pandit Nehru calls, Patelji, what are you doing? Are you mad? You want to reconstruct that temple? For what for? Why should there be a temple in Gujarat that has been destroyed 18 times? Why do you want to destroy? You may believe in God, but your scriptures say God is in your heart. Why build temples? Waste of public money. Forget about it. And being a Congress leader, you want to rebuild that? And Patel had to say, Panditji, I am not taking any government funds. So you cannot object. Tooth and nail, Panditji opposed the reconstruction of that temple in Gujarat. Still, against all odds, against strong opposition, Somnath temple had to be rebuilt. That is the kind of republic into we have landed. The Bharat has landed into a republic with these attitudes of leaders. Now if you examine what has happened in these 60 years, the republic has launched in every day some program or the other to make the people feel, dear Hindu, this is not your exclusive country. You are one of the citizens along with all the rest of the population, and you have no exclusive right over this land. You cannot call it your own motherland. You may call it your motherland, but it's not exclusively. You have to share it with everybody else. And slowly we entered into a different scenario when the minorities are more important, now more than equal, not just equals. Just because we allowed things to happen the way that the leaders wanted them to be, what has happened is slowly our right to protest today is called fundamentalism. It is ignorance. They are not living in the spirit of the constitution. So they are violating constitution by talking of Hinduism in India. They should have accepted the Indian Republic as very generously giving a place in India to live alongside other religions with equal rights. That itself is a great concession. We are allowing the Hindus to follow his religion. Constitution is so liberal that the Hindu is allowed to follow Hinduism. That is their definition of the constitution. Now, the country, for example, how do you define the country? It is a geographical area. say from Himalayas to Kerala. We call it Hindustan, call it the Bharat, where certain Sanatana Dharma existed, a religion based on the theory of rebirth, theory of the existence of God as our benefactor, based on the theory that we have to approach one day, reach the God over several births. So in that direction, my journey should proceed on these lines of do's and don'ts. If I pray to the God, yes. For the ultimate, every day the sankalpa is dharma ardha kama moksha chedarvedha palapurrata siddhyartham. Even when you are celebrating a new house entry, housewarming, even there the Purohit says dharma ardha kama moksha chedarvedha palapurrata. It's never to be forgotten, never to be given up, even in a mundane activity. This is the Hindu dharma that has been handed down to us. It's a very strange thing that the bulk of the Hindu population do not protest, whereas very strong reaction ought to be there. Even a mild protest is not found to be there. The press, the media, the intellectuals, the secularists, are the anti-Hindu Hindus, they speak so much about it. Who are the communists in this country? Don't you see that all of them are Hindus by birth? Is there a Muslim communist? Is there a Christian communist? How come all the communists are Nastikvadis, are only Hindus? This is the result of a foreign rule, a continued Mughal rule, and the so-called reformist activity within the Hindu society, condemning many practices of the Hindus as outdated. Indian Hinduism or Hindu religion certainly needed some reforms. It did need some reforms. Maybe some beliefs are blind, some practices are outdated. They have no place in a civilized society, maybe. And the Britishers made much of the sati practice. Was every woman burning herself on the fire of her husband? Was it a practice going on in India? And if that was the practice, why are there so many rules about a widowhood? The dharma gives so many do's and don'ts to a widow, which means the wife survives the husband, not necessarily burning herself on the fire. That is the majority. One in 1,000 might have gone on the fire. And that is one of the reasons pointed out by the British thinkers that India is still barbaric. It is still living in ignorant times. Barbarism still is ruling the Hindu mind and practice today. And many, many such practices were condemned while we were quite aware of what we were doing. And even persons like Raja Ram Mohan Roy invited the British. He wrote letters to the British government, to company bosses. I am happy to note that you have started educating my colleagues in India. Your schools are welcome. English education is the most welcome, so that we may come out of our dark ages and come forward. Some of the letters written by Raja Ramandu, we don't know. If you look at them, how much of condemnation he had in mind about the Hindu practices. Surprising to see. And we think, without knowing what he said, what he wrote, what he did, we worship these leaders. What about Mr. Gandhi? Was he not an educated lawyer in the Inner Temple of London? He became a lawyer. He addressed the British judges, "Your Lordship." He was a faithful Indian, British Indian citizen. He took pride in being a British citizen, practicing law in South Africa. I am a British citizen. I am an Indian. I passed out to the Inner Temple in London. I am an Bharat law. I am a barrister. But when he was insulted in a railway train, the real Mahatma woke up. like Chanakya. Chanakya also faced a serious insult at the hand of a bad ruler. He could wreak vengeance. He did not sleep till the empire fell. So something personal should have happened to these great patriots to become revolutionaries. And as the moment we got our independence, Nehru was looking to the Russians for inspiration, not any other country. Before 5 or 6 or 7 years before independence, he toured Russia. While in 1947, what was the age of the Russian Republic under Stalin? From 1919 to 47, hardly 30 years or 25 years. It was still in the making. Day before yesterday, we read in the papers, President Putin joined his services in memoriam of those killed by the secret police of Stalin just because they protested against the fundamentalist rule of the communists. Suppression and repression was there. At least 20,000 well-meaning citizens were killed by the... That was the source of inspiration for Pandit Nehru. He was new, he was in the know of things about what was happening in the new Russia. A few decades later, communism has been given a go-by. Lenin's statue was dumped into the museum. And they declared independence. Independence from communism. Independence from communism. And communists are dictating terms to the government of India. A government that rules this country has no regard for the heritage of this country. Somebody who rules the government is there elsewhere. Government is ruling the country, somebody is ruling the government. They have no regard for what is. And when a particular governor had to be appointed in a particular Indian state, you know, the lady said, this man always talks about Sanatana Dharma and all that. Is he all right? Can he hold the chair of a governor? Is not something wrong with him? He speaks. I heard him writing about Sanatana Dharma and things like that. He must be a very backward man. How can you select him as governor? He dismissed the... She returned the file without approval. These are facts known to me. This is the governance of this country. So that is the Republic of India. The ancient Dharma and India are the Bharatvarsha. And this third thing is the state of India. A republic is called a nation. When we deal with other countries, it is international relationships, not inter-country. Government to government, constitution to constitution, the interaction takes place. The country is silently watching whether they like it or not. The policies of the government of India do not reflect the feelings of Indians, particularly the Hindus. They can enter into any contract with any other country. The citizen has no knowledge of it. Here the role of the citizen comes into play. The citizen of the republic should be a citizen fundamentally of the Bharatvarsha. Then he should be then citizen of India, that is Bharat. That is, we have to assert ourselves as citizens of the Indian Republic, that is in public life. In our cultural private life, we should be the citizens of Bharat. And citizens of the Indian state, if the state in machinery is not recognizing your personal culture, fight against it as a citizen. I am a citizen of Bharat first. I don't agree with this republican concepts. It is not taking care of my heritage, my religion, my values. It is giving a very petty treatment to my heritage. So I refuse to be a citizen of this republic, but I assert myself as a citizen of Bharata.